Let me add to the voice to say welcome to St. Nick's. As has been said, I'm here on placement, so let me publish a disclaimer. If I happen to say any heresy, please manage it. But if you feel that the heresy is too much, that you want to take actions about that, please write to the vicar of the church and not to my woman in Panama Hall. Let us pray. Open our hearts to your word and your word to our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I would love to lay a foundation to the Bible passage we just read today, because it's going to help us understand where we are coming from and where we are going to. The book of John opened with John the Beloved talking about Jesus in a new way which the other Gospels did not talk about, as the Word. He declared that this Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. And he proceeded to start to talk about someone else, who is John the Baptist. In that time, some people wanted to know who John was, whether he was an impostor, Elijah, the Messiah, or whatever. And he came to John. John said, I am none of these. I am just the voice of him that cries in the wilderness. Then he asked, what do we care? And they were really confused. But unfortunately, John did not give them any other answer apart from that he is the voice that cries in the wilderness. The next day, Jesus was passing by, and John said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And another day, which is the day we read today, John was with two of his disciples, Andrew. Some Bible scholars said that the other disciple should be John the Beloved, who wrote the book of John we are reading. So as Jesus was walking by, John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And I began to ask myself, what does it actually mean that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world? Then we have to go back to the Old Testament to understand what this means, because in the present time we do not actually understand sacrificial cultures or cultures where sacrifice is part of the worship. Then we have to go back to the Old Testament. And now we see that from the days of Cain and Abel, there were sacrifices of offerings to God. But in the days of Moses, it concretized into having specific animals in a specific way. It has to be sacrificed in order to worship God. And one of those animals has to be the lamb. But in the days of the children of Israel in Egypt, the lamb took a new term. And that was the last thing they did before they left Egypt. And that is the Passover feast they had before they left Egypt. And it is important that we begin to understand what actually the Passover is. The Passover, as I said before, is the last thing they did before they left Egypt. They had to kill this lamb, and they had to smear the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, so that when the angel of death came, it will pass by, it will pass over. And this begins to give me some excitement to understand that John was saying, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb of God who brings restoration. Behold the Lamb of God that when the angel of death comes, it's going to pass by you. It is not going to stand with you. And that was what John was saying, behold the personification of that redemption of God. It came to life. It's no longer a thing of theory. It's no longer what they did because of their father's deed. John was saying, behold this life here now. And what does that mean? That the blood has to be put on the doorpost. I begin to remember that when Cain killed Abel in the book of Genesis chapter 4, the Bible said that the blood of Cain cried from the ground. And in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 24, it said that the blood of Jesus pleads for us before the throne of God. It speaks much more than the blood of Abel. Therefore, we have a blood that speaks for us. The blood of Jesus is not just something that happened. It's something that transforms wholly. It starts from the core of your being and transforms even to your personality, even to the way you do things, without you recognizing it, just because you accepted the power in that blood to go through you. And that was what John was saying. Behold the Lamb of God. The disciples got excited about it, that they left John. The excitement got so much that they left John and began to move towards Jesus, who is that Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. I love food very much, good food. And over this Christmas, I went to my cousin's. Wow, she can cook. She has anointing for good food. So, some of the mornings when I, you know, when the aroma of a food wakes you up, and I get to the kitchen and she's saying, "How was your night?" I'm like, "What are you cooking?" That was the excitement that caught the disciples. That when they left John and began to follow Jesus, Jesus turned back and said, "What do you want?" That question was not important to them. They wanted something else. And Jesus was asking them a wrong question. They were not interested in what they want. They just wanted to abide with Christ. And that actually reminds me of where I come from. In my country, Nigeria, we answer questions with questions. If you make the mistake of asking a Nigerian, are you going to church today? They might ask you, "Are you now my priest?" It's a polite way of telling you, "I don't want to answer your question." Really, it's quite polite. So the disciples at this moment, they were really Nigerians. Jesus was asking them the wrong question. They wanted something much more. They wanted something more glorious. That power in the name of Jesus, that redemption that the Lamb of God brings, that was what they were looking for. And Jesus was asking them, "What do you want?" Perhaps they wanted to say everything about you. It was very exciting for them. It was very powerful. And that was what they wanted. And Jesus said to them, "Come and see. Come and see." And they came. They followed Jesus. But before they left, Andrew said that this is too good to go alone. He ran and called his brother, Simon, who in the same chapter, when we read down, we see that he was renamed Peter. He could not carry this message alone. He could not go alone. It was too good. He needed to share this. And I tell you today, how do we treat what we have? The gospel of Christ. This year we must be determined to move and follow Jesus, to go to where Christ is staying. That might be in the place of prayer. That might be in the place of reading the word. That might be in the place of fellowship. That might be in the place of keeping quiet and sitting in the presence of God. Sometimes we talk a lot when we come into the presence of God. Some days God doesn't need that. He just wants you to sit down and enjoy his presence. I never knew the power of silence until I lived with Catholic priests when I went to France. After our morning prayer, we remained silent. The first day I was like, "Is there anything happening?" But gradually I began to feel that there's something beautiful in sitting in the presence of God without saying anything. That might be what you need, that might be what I need. But there's a movement today. The disciples decided to move. They decided to leave John. Perhaps there's something you need to leave today. It must not be bad. But you might move. There might be need for a movement. Maybe from praying for 5 minutes to an hour. It's not too much. It might be just 5 minutes of reading the word. It might be just texting somebody with an encouraging word to say, "Be encouraged." It might be the little things of life. It might not be big. But I know a God that uses the small things of life to do mighty things. He says he uses the foolishness of this found the wisdom of the wise. And John is telling us all this, that we should behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Today is the Epiphany Sunday, 12th night after Jesus was born. And today was actually when we believe the wise men came. Jesus was revealed to the Gentiles. You and I would have been called Gentiles. But today, John is pointing us to Christ. He's telling you and I, behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And I ask you today, perhaps this year might be looking stressful for you. Maybe it's just to behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, and just come and abide with Christ, who is able to change everything about you. Maybe you are here. This Christian message is like, I don't know what to do with this. It's not convincing enough. All I can say to you is, come and behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You must not believe it. Just come. Christ will not reject you. Don't come because you are righteous. Don't come because you are good. If you talk of good, I'm nothing good. But it's just because the Lamb of God has come. So what? I don't know how you've planned your 2019, but perhaps you are not sure what it looks like. Come to God. Come to Jesus. Come to the Messiah. Come to the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's able to change everything about you and give you a hope and a focus for this year. I trust that God will do something beautiful in your life this year. Today is the first Sunday in 2019. I'm trusting God who is able to do much more than we can even imagine. But we simply have to do one thing, to behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Paul said, leaving behind everything, I push on, I strive on, I go on to take hold of that which Christ took hold of me. Perhaps that may be what you need for this year. But whatever it is, if you've not heard anything I said today, just hear this. Behold the Lamb of God and call Jesus. It is with his hands wide open to receive us in any circumstance we found ourselves. Let us pray. Just start.